Positive Thoughts Part 5 Compiled by Hussein Fahmy How can you merchandise your ideas? First, select the idea you want to accomplish. Second, define and enumerate the idea in terms of service, thing or proposition and visualize its values and advantages in concrete terms. Third, arrange the idea and its advantage in sequence and give it a solid plan or body. Review Chapter 8 and apply its contents. Fourth, idealize the plan, see and feel it attracting attention and getting results. Reinforce your power to do this by the four laws, namely, the law of faith, the law of imagination, the law of repetition, and the law of persistence. Fifth, have plan type written in plain words or have a blueprint made if it is to portray a thing. This will make either of them mean something to you and to others. In applying for a new job or position, review your ideas in the light of your own experience, setting forth in detail past performances, present engagements and what you feel capable of doing. The employer can react only on what you tell him. Leave nothing to chance. Be thorough and explicit. No one has a better idea of what you are capable of doing and no one can tell it better than you. Applying the above principles to merchandise his ability. A young fellow presented his qualifications to his next-door neighbor. He specified his training, gave a complete review of his experience, enumerated his attributes and qualities, visualized and idealized his capabilities and graphically portrayed how the corporation could use and benefit from his services. His next-door neighbor was the president of the corporation. He was so impressed with the plan presenting the young man's work specifications that he immediately employed him at a substantial salary. Today he is vice president of the corporation. Most people are so busy scratching in the dirt that they never stop to think of what the dirt is made. They wonder why they do not get ahead. Now and then one pauses, thinks and analyzes the dirt. He becomes a creative thinker. He uses his head. And the minute he begins to use his head, at that minute he begins to get ahead. Three men were working on a construction site. Someone asked, "What are you doing?" Number one answered, "I am cutting stone." Number two answered, "I am earning $10 a day." Number three answered, "I am building a cathedral." Number three has vision and imagination. He is thinking about that which he is doing. Eventually number three will be conducting his own business. Feeling his seniority rights had been overlooked, an employee went to the president of the company to complain that a younger man had been advanced to a position to which he felt entitled. "Why has my 25 years of experience been ignored?" he queried. The president said, "You have had only 1 year's experience 25 times. Merely putting in hours does not win a promotion. It is injecting your ability in the hours that wins recognition and guarantees a reward. Experience is the knowledge, wisdom and skill gained through a wise use of time. The use you make of spare time will assist you in developing your ability. There are 24 hours in each day. Each week has 168 hours. Your vocation takes up 40 hours. This leaves you with 128 hours each week to sleep, to eat. To entertain, to relax, and to improve yourself. By using only 10% of this spare time, you have almost 2 hours per day to read, to study, to think, to supplicate, to reflect and to improve your capacity to perform. A few hours each week wisely used will enrich your knowledge, broaden your outlook, season your experience and qualify you for a promotion, or an increase in salary. Efficiency and understanding of your job bring added remuneration. Spare time may be organized effectively. To use it constructively is both interesting and profitable. Decide now to make use of it. Work up a program to use it and adhere to it. Spare time, either to develop a hobby, an avocation, or self-knowledge, helps to form good habits. Spare time is your property. One man has as much time as another. No one can deprive you of it. The use you make of it largely determines your progress. Fill each minute with 60 seconds. It is not the days or hours that you waste, it is the precious seconds and minutes. It is the use of these that will make or break you. Take care of the minutes, the hours will take care of themselves, and the days will take care of you. Learn to work and play, full of work and full of play will make your life one long happy holiday. As I drop worry on the way, God was good to me every day. Here are 6 suggestions that will help you to develop your spare time. 1. Try to spend 1 hour each day in reading, reflecting and reviewing. 2. Pick out one subject, take pencil and paper and write down every thought you can think about on that subject. Spend 20 to 30 minutes each day doing this. 3. Write a letter. Try not to use the words I, me, my and mine. 4. Try to converse at least 15 minutes each day without using the words I, me, my and mine. 5. Try to write a little article each day, either explaining, relating or defining something. 6. Spend at least 15 minutes each day reviewing and analyzing your experience. Endeavor to visualize and idealize all your relationships with people in a spirit of gratitude and appreciation. It will help you to discover other people's interests. It will help you to form ideas that are wonderful to others, because others will feel wonderful with your ideas. A piece of glass sparkles more brilliantly than a piece of magnetic iron. There is no comparison as to the quality of attraction. This principle is applicable to human relations. It is a simple matter to attract people by superficial amenities, but to draw the blood and influence them to act, you must have the power of attraction within. A smile may win attention, but it takes the conscious power of ideas to obtain results. A hyena can smile, but when an employer wants something done, he does not employ a hyena. The moral is, do not spend all your time painting the outside of the house, but spend more time on the furnishings. It is here you can make people feel at home, and inspire them to do your own bidding. Someone once said, praise is like a diamond. It derives its value from its scarcity. In the physical world, there are 2 ways to expand things. 1. By pressure. 2. By heat. To expand things elastic, like an automobile tire, air is blown into it or water is poured into it, and the force of pressure of either of these elements expands it. The inherent pressure from within will expand things when heat is applied. Water is converted to steam, and the steam produces power. Metals are heated to a molten state, and while in this state they can be shaped to any form. Heat applied to coal releases rich gases, coal tar products for dyes, and other useful products, even nylon hosiery. In the world of human relations, it is not possible to apply physical pressure or heat to individuals. Another formula must be prescribed. The one formula that will aid you more than all others to expand and grow in your relationships with people is the heat of praise. It seems to be an inherent law that we increase whatever we praise. Creation expands to praise. Praise children and they will glow with joy. Praise your ability with gratitude and you increase the flow of intelligence. Children like praise and so do you. A little sincere pat on the back increases goodwill and in many cases contributes to the success and happiness of others. Positive praise feelingly applied is an active prayer. Practice it. Whatever we praise multiplies. If you are in need of supply, the best way to start the flow of additional supplies is to praise that which you have. If you want a better job and more pay, start praising the work you are doing. Those around you may seem unappreciative, but keep praising your situation and soon they will be thinking your way. You will be amazed how quickly things begin to turn your way. The shortest, surest way to happiness is to thank and praise God for everything that happens to you. For it is certain that whatever seeming calamity happens to you, if you are patient for it, you turn it into a blessing. Praise magnifies the good qualities, and minimizes the bad ones if any. Praise is a positive expression of appreciation. It is being glad over the accomplishments of others. It is something you can't buy. It must be earned, and shared by those who deserve it. It is more than fame and money. It is giving hearty and warm approval to a friend. It is letting him know that you are interested in his welfare. It breaks down barriers and lets you in on situations that would not otherwise be possible. Praise may be called the great liberator. Therefore, when anyone deserves or earns your approbation, by all means give it. You will encourage them and have a greater appreciation of your own qualities. People stop learning too soon. They reach the mature age of 30 and think they can learn no longer. Learn something new, formulate new ideas, develop new interests and generate new enthusiasm. In these you will find new zest, new courage and new inspiration to perfect your job. Ordinary things done in an extraordinary way attract more attention and create more interest than extraordinary things done in an ordinary way. It is not necessary to be an economic royalist to have stars in your crown, friends among your associates and money in your pocket. In attracting people, it is not wise to rely too much on education. Intelligence precedes education. Man had intelligence long before he acquired education. Education comes from the Latin word educare, which means to draw out. The whole process of education is to draw out and develop the latent abilities and to arrange them according to the standard of convention that others may understand and benefit by them. The human consciousness is a product of God. It is created and formed in harmony. Law and order prevail in the human consciousness, and anyone skilled in the knowledge and understanding of human relations forms ideas on this hypothesis. To have the maximum effect, any medium to exchange or to transmit thoughts and ideas must follow this principle. The law of physics, the law of mathematics, and the law of chemistry have been correct. All of these laws are an established principle with no exception. Two parts of hydrogen and one of oxygen made water before man wrote the chemical formula H2O. Two parts added to two more parts made four parts before man discovered mathematics. An apple was falling to the ground the day Newton discovered the law of gravitation. Electricity was available to light the Egyptian pyramids, but the Egyptians did not know how to cut the lines of force, set up a magnetic field and use a dynamo to convert physical force into electrical energy. An airplane flown over Bethlehem the day Jesus, PBUH, was born would have been considered a miracle. Yet the principle of aerodynamics was as applicable then as it is now. Chance is a word void of sense and nothing can exist without cause. So-called luck is based on chance. If that is true, then luck can play no part in obtaining results. Achievement must have a cause. Accomplishments are not pulled out of thin air. They are the results attained by the application of ideas in well-formed plans, loaded with fact, meaning and feeling centered on the needs of people conforming to the law of God, which is the principle of good. Another thought that will help you to attract and get what you want is to recognize and realize that all branches of knowledge teach relationship. Man dreads because he does not understand. Man fails because he does not think. When you love God, you love good, and this establishes order in your relationships that produces unity and that which you do is done with certainty and harmony. This is peace of mind. In all your relations, endeavor to discover what is true, and practice what is good. Believe in yourself, and acquire the habits that will make you believe in yourself. Act as if it were impossible to fail. Keep active. Genius is 1% inspiration and 99% perspiration. Geniuses are only people who keep busy in the perfection of a science or an art. The heights by great men reached were not attained by sudden flight. But they, while their companions slept, were toiling upward in the night. Remember these few precepts. 1. Get the attitude of success. Think and feel it. A flower girl of London looked like a duchess, thought like a duchess, talked like a duchess, acted like a duchess, and soon became a duchess in a play. 2. Operate scientifically. Know all the facts. No business is good enough for a man to spend a day in, but any business is good enough for him to spend a lifetime in. The road to perfection is not crowded. 3. An automobile performs better in high gear, so does your personality. Throw it in gear and go places and do things. 4. Be cheerful. Smile, but do not depend upon it for an increase in salary. 5. Be flexible. Changes are taking place with lightning rapidity. Learn to adapt yourself quickly to conditions and adjust yourself gracefully to people. 6. Study people, find out what they like, and make plans to supply them. 7. Exercise tact and diplomacy. Feel your way along. It is better to get the whole than in parts. 8. Agree with your adversary quickly. The storm does not last very long. 9. Be forgiving. Next time it may be on you. 10. Speak softly. Arrogance and impudence have their reward. 11. Be dependable. If you make an appointment or an agreement, keep it. Let your word be your bond. 12. Think, then act, and you will not grow weary acting. The more you think, the less work you have to do. 13. Be a friend. The only way to have a friend is to be one. Execute all your ideas with a humble and friendly spirit. 14. If you feel the symptoms of self-importance, and a slight attack of big-headedness coming on, take this antidote. Think of all things that have been done, all things that are being done, and all things that will be done, even without you and me. Keep planting ideas. Some will fall upon stony hearts, some will fall upon marble domes, but some will fall upon fertile brains and will bring forth some 30, some 60 and some even 100 folds of good results. The law of averages is a very exacting law. It requires that you plant ideas, but it never fails to justly reward you. When you have earned something, nothing will keep you from getting it. You can attract and get what you want by simply believing in your ideas. They are the substance of things you want, and if you have faith in them, the substance of the ideas becomes the evidence of the things you wanted. Every successful achievement has followed this principle. In this chapter, I have revealed to you the psychological attributes and the spiritual qualities that enable you to attract people, and impel them to be conscious of your ideas. Ideas that conform to a pattern are like music to the ear. They inspire confidence and motivate action by virtue of their own power. They are the very essence of business. They are irresistible. People feel about them the way you feel. You can build and create ideas around the needs of others that will attract attention, stimulate the imagination, wake up the slumbering interest, electrify the latent desires, incite the feeling and move people to action. Your ability to attract and get what you want in yourself does lie. Use it and results will follow as the night the day. Chapter 13. How the Law of Averages Can Make You Rich. Divine laws express justice, and these laws have no favorites, and are available to all who endeavor to understand and apply them. On the other hand, the law of averages is a natural law. It works well with absolute certainty and precision. Man in his quest for knowledge uncovers many natural laws. He reduces these laws to workable things, and through the effects of these laws is able to add to his own comfort and enjoyment. He is able to prove the effects of these laws, and to express them in scientific formulas. The law of averages can be reduced to a scientific formula, and applied in dealing with people. The results may be anticipated with accuracy. In my experience in the field of selling, I have proved that the law of averages applies to human beings as well as to things. A scientific knowledge of the law of averages is one of the most stimulating and fascinating factors in business. The application of this law guarantees success in any field of endeavor. In this chapter, I want to give you first a practical introduction that proves the law of averages in dealing with things and people. Second, I want to give you a scientific interpretation of the law of averages. Third, I want to tell you how the law of averages can make you rich and also how it works. To introduce the scientific application of the law of averages, let us observe a demonstration. Take a coin and toss it into the air 100 times. Mark down the number of times it falls heads, and the number of times it falls tails. What happens? There are two sides to that coin, and both sides are exposed. The law of averages determines the number of times that the coin falls heads and the number of times that it falls tails. As there are only two sides exposed, It must fall an equal number of times heads, and also an equal number of times tails. A coin tossed into the air a sufficient number of times will get the same result every time. There is another demonstration that will interest you. Number 10 golf balls, 1, 2, 3 and right on up to 10. Put them in a sack and shake them thoroughly. Draw 1. The number you draw is 1 of the 10. The law of averages yields number 1 every time during the 10 draws. Draw these balls 100 times, and during the draws the law of averages yields the ball marked number 1 and 2 in succession. Draw these balls 1000 times, and during the draws the law of averages yields the balls marked number 1, 2 and 3 in succession. Draw these balls 10,000 times, and during the draws the law of averages yields the balls marked number 1, 2, 3 and 4 in succession. Draw these balls 100,000 times, and during the draws the law of averages yields the balls marked 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 in succession. Keep the draws up to 10 billion, and during the draws the law of averages yields the balls marked 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 and 10 in succession. If you do not believe it, try it. Either of the above demonstrations will prove that the law of averages works. Since it does work, let us endeavor to define it. One of the greatest thinkers who ever lived had one great motto: define your terms. It is only logical, therefore, that you should know the scientific meaning of the law of averages. If you put something in, you get something out. A very good answer, and it contains the elements of truth. Many millions of people had seen things fall to the ground long before Sir Isaac Newton discovered the law of gravitation. But Newton wanted to know the reason why things fell to the ground. Someone asked him how he discovered the law of gravitation. His answer was, by thinking about it. After thinking many days about the law of averages in terms of application, in terms of demonstration, in terms of relationships, and in terms of how it produces results, I created the following definition. The law of averages is the law that determines the number of times a thing will happen in proportion to the number of times that that thing is exposed. The coin is exposed 100 times. It has two sides only, heads and tails. Therefore, it must fall an equal number of times for each side and will always do this in proportion to the number of times it is exposed. The same principle applies to the golf balls. Expose them enough times and the result you are seeking is bound to happen. The definition of the law of averages establishes it on a scientific basis. Therefore, it will prove very helpful to you to visualize this definition and get it well established in your mind. To know a principle thoroughly inspires us to apply it. Anyone who applies the law of averages based on the above definition cannot fail to produce results. Some may confuse the law of averages with chance. Chance comes from the Latin word cadere, which means to fail. Chance is taking a gamble that a thing will happen. It is a pure risk with the possibility to win based on that imaginary thing called luck. The law of averages is a definite law that eliminates chance, avoids risk and fulfills every requirement to which it is applied. The law of averages is used by all life insurance companies to determine the death rate of a given number of people at a given age. It is the scientific principle on which to compute all mortality tables. Why? Because a given number of people are exposed to death at all times, and therefore, a certain number of deaths will happen each year, with absolute accuracy. This fact, plus the rate of interest earned on the premiums collected, determines the cost of the life insurance per year. The law of averages also applies to the investment portfolio. Out of a given number of companies doing business, a certain number of these companies will be successful. A financial institution can invest in a sufficient number of these companies in order that the law of averages can operate. This provides a reasonable security for an investment and also a guaranteed interest return on the investment. Therefore, by applying the law of averages, a financial institution can invest money scientifically. Most credit risks are based on the law of averages. Out of a given number of credit risks, a certain number will always be responsible and prove to be satisfactory. In all enterprises, the law of averages operates. Some people in business are conscious of this law and expand their enterprises with speed, alacrity, and certainty. Others apply it in a hit or miss fashion, but they by no means reap the rich and full reward of its scientific application. Ignorance of the law is no excuse is an old legal maxim applying to the law of the land. To commit a crime with the plea of ignorance does not excuse the offender. The same principle applies to the divine laws, except these laws are more exacting. To be ignorant of these laws in no way interferes with their operation. The laws are here for us to use, and not to use them is certainly no fault of the laws. The law of averages is a fundamental law. To apply it is to enjoy its rewards. The parable of the sower, which plainly states that the sower must sow his seed before he can expect to reap a crop. Some seed will fall by the wayside, some will fall among thorns, some will fall among the rocks, but some will fall upon good ground and bring forth a crop of 100-fold. The secret of the sower is the kind of seed that he sows. The seed must be of good quality in order to take root when it falls on the right soil. That which he reaps will be of the same nature as that which he sows. If he sows wind, he will reap a whirlwind. If he sows sawdust, he will reap sawdust. Everything increases after its own kind. As the seed contains all the elements essential to the plant, so must ideas contain all elements essential to influence people. You must sow ideas before you can reap a reward. You must give before you can get. So when you sow and when you give, do it freely with no strings to it. You do your part and the seed will do its part. Most of us, most of the time, are thwarted, distracted and discouraged because we have no definite knowledge of a law on which to expand our efforts. Doubt, uncertainty and dread creep into our consciousness, and there is a tendency to vacillate from one goal to another, from one interest to another, and end up by being simply bewildered, and with a shallow sense of being cheated. In applying a fundamental law, be not anxious or overzealous to change your procedure. Remember that natural laws do not vacillate. The laws that rule us are unchangeable. They unfold logically. Observe how logically things in nature grow and develop. Nothing is accidental. They develop in logical sequence and unfold in perfect fruition. The divine law cannot fail. To fail would be a violation of God's own principles. This is impossible. Does the law of gravitation fail? Drop what you have in your hand and see what happens. This law is constantly on the job even though you are not conscious of it. The law of physics, the law of chemistry, the law of mathematics, or any other fundamental law is constantly available for our use. Someone may ask what a dozen eggs will cost at 60 fils each. Instantly, through the law of mathematics, you multiply 12 by 60 and solve the problem. The moment you are conscious of the law, it is there to meet your need. Thus far, I have given you a practical demonstration of the law of averages. I have defined it and have endeavored to interpret it scientifically. From here on, I want to show how the law of averages works for you and for me. The law of averages yields results with the same certainty and accuracy as the law of mathematics, when applied. I not only believe in the law of averages, I not only have faith in it, but more than these, I know the law of averages operates. When I multiply 60 by 12, I know it is 720. Faith and belief in the law of mathematics become ready knowledge. The application of the law of averages becomes ready and usable knowledge the minute it is applied. Not many years ago, I made 1800 calls over the telephone. I did not get a bite. Was I dismayed? Was I frustrated? Was I discouraged? Not in the least. I was exposing an idea in the form of a sales plan portraying the benefits of telesales. I was putting into operation the law of averages. I knew that this law could not fail. Operating on this principle, there was no occasion for doubt. I knew that results were certain. What happened? Within a few days, I struck the jackpot. It rained business. Did the law of averages pay off? In less than 1 month I received more than $8.00 for every telephone call made. In addition, I received a bonus of at least that much more. In the field of selling, the law of averages is very exacting as to the amount of calls necessary for a sale. It certainly requires that you plant ideas, but it does not prescribe the method to use. In fact, the law of averages is absolutely indifferent as to the method you employ to put it in operation. In my experience in selling, I have always used the telephone. I find that the telephone method is the quickest, the most practical, the most efficient, the most feasible and the most scientific method of carrying an idea to the greatest number of people in the shortest period of time. It is the quickest and the most direct means of exposing an idea in a personalized way and, therefore, fulfilling the requirements necessary for the law of averages to operate. In applying the law of averages in the field of selling, it is absolutely necessary to determine the result you desire. The law of averages does not know the objective you desire until the decision is made. Once a decision is reached, the law goes into operation to fulfill it. The number of times you expose an idea about a product or service is the number that determines how often the exposition of that idea will reward you. Most of those people who sell work either on a commission basis or for a salary. If you work on a commission basis, put a definite cash value on each call. If you work on a salary, put a definite estimate of the number of calls you want to make to consummate a sale. Keep a record and watch the law of averages operate. In my own experience, I have always placed a value of $7.00 on each telephone call. Therefore, if I make 50 telephone calls in 1 day, I know I have earned $350.00. To illustrate this fact, it will be of interest to you to know that in June 1991 I began to operate the law of averages on this basis. At the end of December 1991, I found that I had made 3,000 telephone calls and the law of averages paid me not only $7.00 for each call, but again rewarded me with a substantial bonus. You may ask, does the law of averages work among strangers? Does the sun know any strangers? The law of averages knows no strangers, and once it is put in operation it works like a magnet. It attracts and draws to it the thing you desire. Remember the parable of the sower, always rely upon good seed. The value and advantage of the product or service, and what they mean to the prospect, are the seed you sow. To expose ideas built into a sales plan and transmit them with absolute faith and certainty to a given number of prospects puts the law of averages in operation. Are reactions to ideas predictable? Yes, there is nothing more certain to predict than the reaction you will get from a given number of people when you present them with a certain definite idea. A positive action always gets a reaction. This reaction will be favorable or unfavorable. If it is favorable, you act upon it quickly. If it is unfavorable, you forget it and go after another one. Are you seeking a job? Do you want a larger salary? Do you want to improve your present occupation? Apply the law of averages and it can be a decided advantage to bring about any of the above situations. How can this be achieved? Formulate ideas about that which you want to accomplish. Begin to apply these ideas. Keep on trying. Be convinced that the law of averages is working with you and through the process of elimination is helping you to reach your goal. Therefore, by persistence your efforts will be crowned with achievement, and that which you are seeking will automatically manifest itself in your experience. In applying the law of averages, endeavor to be patient. Shake the limb of an apple tree with a green apple upon it, and nothing happens. Shake the limb when the apple is ripe and the apple falls off. The law of averages cannot be forced, coerced, or hastened. When the requirements are met, it operates with precision. Nothing can force it to act, and nothing can prevent it from acting. The law of averages will remunerate you in proportion to the value you yourself put on it. If you demand little, it pays little. If you demand much and set a worthwhile goal, it will always meet your standard. The old saying goes, why put a mountain in labor, just to bring forth a mouse? Remember the old poem by Door of Dreams which says, I bargained with life for a penny, and life would pay no more. However, I bade at evening when I counted my scanty store. For life is just an employer. He gives you what you ask. But once you have set the wages, why, you must bear the dusk. I worked for menials hire, only to learn dismayed that any wage I asked of life, life would have paid. Tell the law of averages what you want. Ask for it, seek it, and demand it in a humble and sincere way, then stick to the demand with faith, with persistence and determination until you have achieved your objective. A chain of ideas puts into operation the law of averages which brings about results. An idea once in print begins to accelerate a process of other ideas, to form a chain of influence, and eventually through the law of averages the idea brings success. In applying the law of averages, remember that you have no control over its rewards or the source from which the rewards come. It rewards you from the most unsuspected sources and in the most unexpected way. As a salesman, you may be all aglow with a sure sale. On the surface, the prospect could not fail. What happens? The prospect does fail to buy. Why? Because he is human. The law of averages, on the other hand, cannot fail, and what you thought only a suspect turns into a genuine sale. This principle applies also to those who seek a job, a larger salary, or an improvement in occupation. The reward comes from the source least expected. The law of averages is unlike man-made law. It cannot be changed, altered, or amended. No act of chicanery, no cunning fraud, and no art of deception can force it to act, or cause it to fail. It can only be put into action by concentrated thought. The true purpose of the law of averages is to give you a definite plan of action with the absolute assurance that the application of your ability cannot fail to produce results. This assurance gives you the power and determination to carry on. The experiences which I have enumerated are not opinions or theories about the law of averages. They are the law of averages in action. This law does not need a favorable place or a favorable time to operate. It will operate for anyone, at any time, or at any place. It requires concentration and application, and these provoke quick thinking. Many constructive thoughts and ideas will come to you as you begin to apply the law of averages. Your ability to express these thoughts and ideas will increase as you need them. Your knack of applying the law of averages will give you many thrills and many checks. It can make you rich. Chapter 14. How to find your place in life. The other day, while looking over the Sunday paper, my eyes were instantly drawn to a picture of a graduating class at one of the large universities. I analyzed that picture. The faces on those boys appeared to be uncertain, not uncertain about life or its future, but uncertain as to the place they could take in it. They seemed to be in a quandary. Were they wondering where it would be possible for them to fit in? Were they wondering how to make the most efficient use of their talents and abilities to tender the best and most useful service? Not only boys graduating from universities and colleges, but thousands of other people are wondering at all times if they are in the right place. Am I a square peg in a round hole, or am I a round peg in a square hole? Am I making the full use of my talents? Are my abilities being channeled in the right directions? Is there not some occupation or thing that I can do more efficiently? Are my efforts being fully appreciated? These are typical questions people ask themselves. Most everyone is seeking to find, or to improve, his place in life. He wants a place in the sun, where his knowledge and skill may be applied with efficiency and where unity, harmony, and peace of mind may be enjoyed. Is there a system or a guide to help people find their true place in life? Is it necessary to stumble hither and yon with no definite objective? After giving this subject much thought, I evolved 5 steps to help you. Take these 5 steps and you will be in your place. 1. Take stock of your ability. If you were going to engage in a business, the first sensible and practical thing to do would be to take a complete inventory. You would survey its present location, inspect the building, make an inventory of the stock, appraise the fixtures, list its assets and tabulate its liabilities. You would quietly analyze these data. You would visualize the business in relation to the customer. You would study his needs and wants, and make provision to supply them. Your chief desire would be to render a good service to the customer and to earn a reasonable profit. You would study also the opportunities of the business, work out methods to improve them, and endeavor to realize and to capitalize on its possibilities. The same principle applies to you. You are in a sense a merchant, and your business is to merchandise your ability. When you bought this book, it became your silent partner. By using its contents in conjunction with your business, there is no limit to where you can go. The central location of your ability is in your occupation. It matters not what it is, or where it is located, it has unlimited possibilities for improvement and expansion. The building from which you operate is your body. It must be maintained and kept in good condition. It must be well fed and well treated. It supplies the energy with which to perform and gives vitality to the ability. It qualifies you to work with efficiency. Keep it in good condition by applying the principles in how to double your energy. Your stock of goods represents your thoughts. Are you dishing out negative thoughts to drive the customer away? Are you using positive thoughts to increase the business and to fulfill your desires? Read It Might Have Been You. Are you making full use of your stock in the basement? Do you bring it out, let people know what you have? You can draw on your stock in the basement, and make full use of it by reading Are You 9/10 Underwater? Do you observe the customer's needs? Do you concentrate on methods and plans to satisfy those needs? Have you his name listed correctly and can you recall the last transaction? Do you reason out his wants in advance and contemplate how to take care of them? Do you stir in a little of the priceless ingredient every now and then, that he may know your real value and spread your name around among his neighbors? How to increase your power to think and to build, catalogues all these and tells you how to make the wisest use of them. Do you use the right words in presenting your stock, in order that the customer may have full confidence and a complete knowledge of what you can do for him? The key to a fortune tells how. Have you enthusiasm for your business, and can you generate it in yourself, and also in the customer? Read How to Generate Enthusiasm. Do you lack faith in your business? Is your stock getting shop-worn and ragged around the edges? Read The Most Interesting Thing in the World, and watch your business improve. Are you making the full use of your ideas to improve the stock, stimulate buying interest, and enlarge the business? New ideas about commonplace things often attract attention, and arouse buying interests in the customer. Read How to Turn Your Ideas into Money. Are you anxious about the future of your business? Are you concerned about a shortage in stock? Are you uncertain and doubtful about conditions? Is your peace of mind perturbed? Review How to Make Use of the Present. Have you inspected your fixtures lately? How about your equipment to display your merchandise? Your speech, voice and manner are the best fixtures you have. A good overhauling will improve them. It will help you to display your stock, and make it easy for the customer to understand and have full confidence in what you say. Review how to improve your speech, voice, and manner. You are a good merchant. You have a wonderful reputation. The Rotary Club wants to know how you do it. You are called upon to make a speech. You can do it. Read How to Make a Speech. Do you want more business? Do you want to attract more customers? Do you want people to feel kindly toward you? Do you want to extend your services? How to attract and get what you want, tells you how to do it. Is your merchandise on display at all times? Are you exposing it to the greatest number of people, in order to increase the number of customers? The law of averages never fails. Read how the law of averages can make you rich. When you take stock of your ability in the light of this analysis, and use the chapters of this book to coach and guide you, you are going to be a going concern on any corner. You will have an unlimited working capital, and a surplus sufficient to weather any storm. Your place in life will be secure. 2. Practice self-reliance. The other day I took a walk in the woods. I came to a very beautiful tree. I plucked a leaf from that tree. I observed its form, its size, its color, and also the many lines running through its body. In symmetry and design, no artist could have imitated its beauty. In texture and construction, no sculptor could have approximated its formation. Every line from stem to tip had its place. It was an expression of perfection, the apex of quality. From the same tree, on a nearby limb, I plucked another leaf. On the tree its appearance was identical with the one that I had just examined. As they hung on the tree it was impossible to tell them apart. However, when I put those leaves side by side, and compared them, I instantly discovered a decided difference. Each leaf was perfect, and each one had its own form, size, color, lines and what I call its own leafality. I plucked from the same tree a dozen more leaves and, on close analysis, I found each leaf had its own individuality. I began to study the tree. Very near was another tree. At close range the general appearance of those two trees was almost the same. I walked a few feet away, and looked at those trees. I discovered a decided contrast in their contour. I examined the limbs, the twigs and the bark of those trees, all bore a striking similarity, and also a striking contrast. The trees, like the leaves from the tree, have an individuality. The analytical description of the trees and the leaves establishes one fundamental principle that exemplifies individual self-reliance. Self-reliance bestows on them the power to draw on, and to absorb all the forces around them with a capacity to fulfill a natural law. The appearance of each tree and each leaf indicates a complete fruition of health, harmony, unity and prosperity. All animals practice the doctrine of self-reliance. They follow their natural instinct, which is a natural spontaneous impulse of propensity, moving them without reason toward action, essential to their existence, preservation and development. By adhering to this instinct, they are fed, sustained and maintained in their natural habitat, and live a complete and full life. All birds and fowls follow their natural instinct, and they too are fed, nourished and sustained, maintained and directed in what to do and how to do it. All things in nature practice and demonstrate the power of self-reliance. To observe the acts of plants, trees, birds, fowl, animals, fish and insects should be an inspiration to every man to practice self-reliance. Observe the lilies of the valley. They toil not, neither do they spin, and yet Solomon in all his glory is not arrayed like one of these. Observe the robin that built a nest in your backyard, as he goes south in November and returns the following spring to his old nest. Observe the homing pigeon being shipped 1,000 miles away from his home. When released without compass or chart, he circles a moment, and then makes a beeline back to his home. Observe the salmon returning after years at sea to the exact river in which he was born. Observe a bee 5 miles away from its hive, equivalent to 1,000 miles for a man, returning laden with its pollen. Observe the horse keeping in the road on the darkest night. Observe the bear hibernating. Observe the dog without map, guide or road sign, scenting his way home 1,000 miles away. Do not forget the self from which you sprang. These are only a few examples. The list is infinite. This must prove that God, the supreme intelligence of the universe, works in and through all things, including man. God knows his business. He makes no mistakes. Everything created by him has a place, or it would not have been created. You have a place. You are an individual. Your fingerprints indicate this. Of all the millions of fingerprints on record, no two are alike. Your fingerprints distinguish you. You are a complete entity possessed with all the qualities and attributes to unfold into a perfect individual. You cannot imitate another's fingerprints, and neither can you ape another's ability. You must rely on your own. You must practice self-reliance. What is self-reliance? It is relying on your own mental resources, judgment and ability to perform. It is absolute trust in the integrity of your own mind. Integrity is the quality of being complete. It is the independence of individuality and helps you to realize that no part of you can be separated from the whole of you. You have got what it takes at any time or any place. All you have to do is to rely on it. Think, speak and act your latent convictions and they shall be the means to influence all men. Self-reliance is the power to believe in your own thought, and to act as if it were impossible to fail. Conventional methods and orthodox procedure are excellent guides, but they are very poor teachers. That which each can do best, none but his creator can teach him. In the distance I can hear a wood thrush. The loud, clear notes are an exquisite arrangement of tone and pitch blending into the concord of sweet sound. It is music at its source. I pause. The wood thrush never had a lesson in voice culture. It teaches a lesson on self-reliance. Situations arise from time to time where it is absolutely necessary to practice self-reliance. Conditions must be met on the spot. You must either sink or swim. One encounters many of these situations in selling by telephone. Man is born with an instinct, the instinct of self-preservation. When he acquired the power of conscious thought, he changed the name of instinct to intuition, but he did not change its source, purpose, quality or power. Intuition may be defined as a quick perception without conscious attention or reason. It is ready knowledge from within, knowledge that is always available to act in an emergency, to thwart a disaster, or to avert a calamity. I like to think of intuition as the trunk line of communication directly to God. Often hunches present themselves. Sometimes a hunch tells you what to do instantly. Self-reliance is one of the fundamental principles of existence. It develops character and will help you to perfect yourself, and to perfect yourself is to perfect your place in life. To reform a nation, to reform a world, no wise man will undertake and all but foolish men know, the only solid and thorough reformation is what each one begins and perfects on himself. 3. Let your light shine. Have you ever turned on the light in a dark room? It makes a vast difference. Yet nothing has changed. The only thing lacking was light. A little light makes a big difference. It matters not where you are or what you are doing, the minute you light up your consciousness, you light up the place around you. The best way to light up your place in life is to turn on the light of optimism. Optimism comes from the Latin word optimus, which means best. It is looking for the best in everything and everybody. The optimist is right. The pessimist is right. One sees things in the light. One sees things in the dark. Each is right. They only see things from different points of view. The optimist sees things as they are, and is able to establish their proper relations. The pessimist only sees a small part of things, and is unable to establish their true relationship. The optimist has knowledge enlightened by facts. The pessimist has knowledge but it is dimmed by ignorance. The optimist sees the donut, the pessimist sees the hole. Optimism is thinking straight. It is an excellent vaccine to prevent failure. It is maintaining a sense of equilibrium regardless of what happens. It puts in practice the adage, whatever happens at all happens as it should happen. When you walk toward the light, the shadows are back of you. When you walk away from the light, the shadows are before you. Practice and demonstrate optimism in your affairs. Always walk toward the light and endeavor to encourage others to walk with you. Let your light shine. Trim the wick with kindness, and feed it with the oil of optimism. Optimism is like digging a hole in the ground. The more you take from it, the larger it gets. You can share it with others, because it is inexhaustible. It is also like a sweet-scented perfume, you cannot spread it around without getting some of it on yourself. Share optimism with others. Be as happy about their success as you are about your own. Never kick a man who is down, or aid the gossip of the town, and if you hear of one gone wrong, think your best to make him strong. Always remember to let your light shine. 4. Keep on the move. There is nothing permanent in the world but change. Everywhere this law is evident. Everything in nature is always on the move. Movement teaches a great natural law. It tells you to keep on the move. It tells you to keep active. It is more fun to wear out than to rust out. Keep on keeping on. As an old proverb says, he who tills the soil shall eat. Keep on the move. It is the real way of life. Watch the bees flit from blossom to blossom in search of honey. Observe the ant, consider her ways and be wise. Every cell in your body is active. Everything around you is on the move, so why not you and I? When you keep on the move, you advance. Grass does not grow under moving feet. Keep on the move and you form good habits. You turn pessimism and defeat into action and achievement. You turn negative thinking and discouragement into positive thoughts of confidence and power. You turn failure into success. Positive thoughts continued in part 6. Compiled by Hussein Fahmy.